Hello and welcome on our YouTube channel. Today I will speak a bit about the arts of the table and I will try to dispel some of the myths which are around it. And for that I will bring you something that I purchased recently. This is from Germany. A maker sent it to me recently. And I will make a little review and explain how it was used and the purpose of it. So. Okay, so, whoa. That's very packed. As you can see, it's a huge box, but I'm sure, because I know what I ordered, it's way smaller inside. So let's get rid of that. Well, yeah, it's in ceramic, so I understand that he took a lot of precautions to make sure that it would arrive to me in a good condition. Okay. I think that's it. So it's smaller but still quite an impressive piece in terms of size. Okay. Oh. This begins already to look clean. And here is the aquamanile. So the aquamanile is part of the medieval kitchenware, which is quite often overlooked. Aquamanila, which means aqua water, and manila hands. And so it is meant to wash your hand with water. So how does it work? This is actually a bottle. Here on the head, you can see that there is a hole, and through this hole, you can fill the bottle. So here I prepared some water and I hope. And so now that the bottle is full, you can, with your guests, verse some of the water through this hole there on their hands. And you can see that the water is actually pouring very gently because the hole is very small. So the point of this thing is to ensure that your guests and yourself have clean hands before you get to the table. So you can remove some of the dirt, some of the grime from the day. This will allow you to have clean hands in order to eat, and you can also clean your hands afterwards. Where did this fashion come from? So first the fashion came from Orient, where Muslims used it, and then it came into Europe and it was used during ceremonies. Those were made or out of ceramic or out of precious metals. But nowadays the very precious one disappeared because they were remelted to make other objects very precious as well. But the copper alloy ones, which were not that precious, stayed in the same state, and that's how we can see them nowadays. The original for this piece was made into a copper alloy as well. When the nobility saw the aquamaniles being used by priests, they thought that they could use them at home, for example, to wash the hands of their guests when they would come at the table. And so that's how those aquamaniles came into more noble households. Oh, I chose this aquamanile because I love the story behind this shape. It's a very unusual shape. something a little bit naughty, something we wouldn't expect maybe from medieval history. And yes, like most of the aquamaniles are totally different. Or you have like knights riding a horse, or you have like animals from medieval bestiaries. You can find different things like lions, like dragons, this kind of thing. But you find also people from the Greek mythology. For example, there is an aquamanile which depicts Chiron fighting a dragon. And here it's something like that. It's also from Greece. Here it's Aristoteles and Phyllis. And the story is very interesting actually, because not just Aristoteles, it's Aristoteles and Alexander the Great which are involved in this story. So why was Aristoteles so important for the medieval culture? His writings were rediscovered in the 12th century via translations directly from Greek, but also translations from Averroes and other Arab writers. And so his philosophy came into the church and mixed with the theology. And so it was very important for all the thinkers to be very well aware of Aristoteles' writings. It is actually very well portrayed in The Name of the Rose from Umberto Eco. Umberto Eco was a very good medievalist and he fully understood the importance of such a philosopher into the medieval culture.
Yet, Aristotle devoted his second book of Poetics to comedy as an instrument of truth.
You have read this work?
No, of course not. It's been lost for many centuries.
No, it has not. It was never written. Because Providence doesn't want futile things glorified.
And so there is this book, the second book of Poetics on Comedy from Aristotle, which is like a mythic book that the hero is trying to find into the library. And this book could have helped the quarrel which is in the background of the movie between different orders of monks. And so you can see that his writings were taken very seriously. And so I would really encourage you to see the movie, The Name of the Rose, or read the book, which is even better. It's really interesting. The second character of this story is Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great is one of the nine worthies. The nine worthies came from the Les Neuf Preux in French, which is a group of nine people, a bit like the Avengers nowadays, which are like revered for their bravery. In this context, there is nine people. Those nine, there is three who are pagans, three who are Jews, and three who are Christians. And Alexander the Great was one of the three pagan ones. So he was selected from the writers of the medieval period as one of the only nine great people in history that should be revered for their bravery and their acts. So now, what's the story which brings those two very interesting characters together? Actually, it happens when Alexander the Great was still a student of Aristoteles. He was there to learn his duties as a king, and then he would become Alexander the Great, like later in history. But at that time, he was in love, or he fell into the charms of Phyllis, a young lady of the court. And yeah, he didn't follow the lessons of Aristoteles with a great concentration, let's say, because he was distracted because of Phyllis. So Aristoteles thought, if Alexander is not following my lessons correctly, then he will not be a great ruler. So I need to tell him. I need to ask him to stop seeing this young lady. And that's what he did, basically. He went to Alexander and he told him, what are you doing? You know, you are young and you need to learn before being a ruler. When Alexander followed the advice of Aristoteles, the young Phyllis felt that, she didn't have the attention of the young lord at that time. And so she concocted a plan. And she said, I will try to seduce Aristoteles himself. And so that's what she did. Like little by little, by little attentions and so on, she seduced him and he fell totally in love with her. And at that moment, she said, I know you're in love with me and I am ready for you. But before that, I have only one request. And she asked him to write him in the courtyard. Of course, Aristoteles was like, you know, I am mad for you, but I will never do that. Because it's quite shameful. But she said, yeah, that's the only thing I ask you. I ask you to make a shameful act. And after that, you can have me to all the extent that you want. Let you imagine what it means. And so Aristoteles, because he was madly in love, agreed to that. They found a moment when it looked like there was no one in the courtyard. And that's what he did. He went on all fours and let Phyllis ride him. But at that moment, Phyllis already knew that he would accept. So she told Alexander. Alexander was actually hidden in the corner of the courtyard. And at that moment, he saw Aristoteles on all fours with Phyllis on his back. And he came and he laughed. And Aristoteles was so shameful. He fell on his knees. And that's when he asked him, like, oh, Alexander, I am so sorry. I understand now that you fell in love with this woman. And even a person with as much knowledge as me is no match for a woman with those charms. And so that's the moral of this story, that even the wisest person is still at the mercy of a beautiful woman with a lot of charm. Now that I told you the story of Aristoteles and Phyllis, let's have a look from a bit closer to the sculpture itself. As you can see, they are not wearing at all proper Greek garments from the ancient time. They are wearing, actually, as you would see in all illuminations at the time, contemporaneous clothing to the time the art was made. In this case, an aquamanile. So you can have a look at Aristoteles, and you see that he's wearing baggy sleeves, he has pointy shoes, and he has a forked beard with also a very nice decorated belt. So all that is indicating a courtier, very fashionable clothing for the time. For Phyllis, you can see that she is wearing a nice belt there with decorations on it, which probably would be gold or silver, something quite fashionable. And she is wearing a very nice dress with an open neckline. And on her sleeves, she is wearing what's called tippets there, which is bands of cloth hanging from the elbow. And so those tippets are cut with little motifs called dagging. And so, yeah, that's also a very fashionable dress for the time. What's very surprising, though, is that she's not wearing anything on her head, apart from the hole, which is there, obviously, for the water. But she's wearing no headgear. And at first, I thought that was a question like of link with the story which is represented by this aquamanile. But in fact, when I had a second look, when I was editing the video actually, to the back of the head, you can see that there is a hinge. And so it is possible that actually there was a headgear, and that this headgear was used to close the opening on the head of Phyllis. And so if you want to recreate something, it's very important to study the source thoroughly and to make sure to compare it with other sources which might not be broken, for example. So you have always to keep in mind the context when you see artwork, because otherwise you might be misled on what's proper to wear or not in reenactment. In conclusion, this aquamanile is very interesting, and you see the etiquette which is linked to it when they would wash the hands of other people. You see the stories that they would share, like those Aristoteles, Alexander, those great people. You see also the clothing of the time. You can have an idea of the shared values that this society in the medieval time would share. And yeah, in conclusion, it's very different from the image that most people have of Middle Age. And yeah, maybe you keep that in mind when you see a movie with a banquet with blood everywhere, with people having very bad manners. Actually, probably in nice places, this kind of thing would be the norm. And yeah, you would see a lot of culture being displayed on the table. And those people would be very interesting to speak with. If you like this video, please subscribe, like the video, and join us on social media. We hope to see you very soon for another video.